Papa, t'es pas ma dessinée?
Tu veux que moi je te dessine? Mais je sais pas dessiner, moi. This is typical of what Dr. Carol Dweck calls a fixed mindset. It basically means that you believe you're either good or bad at something. You can't really change, even if you really want to. And although this is not directly related to teaching your child to read and write in your home languages, her book, Mindset, has had a huge impact on the way I do it with my sons and how I teach as well my students in class. So this week, I have decided to share with you the couple of big lessons I have taken away from her book. Let's dive in! Hello everyone, this is Yoshito Darmachi Maomori. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm the founder of the Library for Multilinguals, and on this channel, I share with you tips on how you can teach your child to read and write in your home languages in a fun way. So if this is a topic that interests you, make sure you subscribe to the channel and you click on the bell icon. Before I share with you the two big lessons I took away from her book, Mindset, I'm going to explain how she defines a fixed mindset and a growth mindset. So a fixed mindset is thinking that you were born a certain way. You're able to do something, but even if you really try, there is no way you can improve. On the other hand, a person who has a growth mindset understands that they were born with certain innate abilities. However, if they put the work into it, they can definitely improve. Someone who has a fixed mindset would see failure as a judgment, that's the end. However, a person with a growth mindset would see failures as a lesson. So I failed there. What did I do wrong? How can I improve? On this note, I would like also to mention a wonderful TED talk from Mark Rober about the Super Mario effect, as he calls it. The Super Mario effect is related to the video games. So when we play and we lose, we always try to understand where we went wrong. How can we do it better next time so we get to the end? And gamifying the learning is a great way to help people develop a growth mindset. So seeing failures as a way to improve. What did I do wrong this time? How can I do better next time? And my book, The Parent's Guide to Raising Multilingual Children, is entirely based on this notion of having fun, gamifying the learning so that your child can carry on learning, making more effort, even if they find it hard. It's also very important to remember that in many cases, people have both mindsets in different areas. So you might think, oh yeah, I know I can improve on this. However, I'm really bad at this, and no matter how much effort I'm going to put, there is no way I'm going to get better. For me, that was the case for drawing. I never thought I was good at drawing. I could copy more or less well, but drawing from my imagination was really, really hard. And I always thought that, okay, some people are good at this, but I'm not. And when my eldest was 2 years old, he loved animals. So he was asking me all the time to draw animals. And how can you say no to a 2 year old? So I was drawing elephants, giraffes, zebras, all sorts of animals that he wanted me to draw. And I have to say that at the beginning, they were not that good, but he was pleased with them. But the more I drew, the more I practiced, the better I got at it. And it's fair enough, I was putting about at least half an hour every day drawing different animals. So there, after a while, I realized that, okay, that's true. We can actually improve on anything we want. It's just putting the practice, putting the time into it. But if we think, okay, there is no way I can improve, we are never going to put the time to do it. So it's important to keep this mindset of we can improve. We just need to put in the practice. And that's going to be the same for us, but also for our children. We need to help them understand that if they want to improve, they need to put in the practice, the time. And this is true for you, for me, for everyone. So now let's start with the first lesson I took away from her book, Mindset. That can be summarized with the saying, every master was once a disaster or a beginner. I can't remember what the saying was. Anyway, Learning to read and write is a journey. It takes time, it takes practice to become better and better. And it's not in a few days that you get better, it's over years. We need to help our children develop this mindset of, okay, I'm good at that level at the moment, I just need to put more effort, more practice to get better and better. Because let's be honest, there will be some setbacks, some moments where your child will be discouraged or just won't want to read more or try to write in their home languages. They might tell you what's the point. So I'd like to share with you how I've done it with my sons. Every time they wanted to give up on something, I had a conversation with them, trying to encourage them to carry on. The first time it happened is when my eldest was doing gymnastics, and he started at 4 years old. He was the youngest. He had just started. Everyone else had started at least a year ago. So obviously they were much better than him. So he felt discouraged comparing himself to what others could do. And after a few months, he wanted to stop. So I told him that it was normal because the other had more practice and to carry on just a few more months. And if after 3 months, he still wanted to give up, we would be okay with that. So in my mind, when I said that, I thought, okay, 3 months is not that much. I hope he's going to see the difference. And luckily he did. So he carried on with gymnastics, and after some point, the coach even asked him to do the examples for some exercises, and that encouraged him. He saw that he was improving, he was getting better, and he was now the example for others. And then later on, when he was doing swimming and he wanted to give up because he wasn't progressing as fast as he wanted to, he thought it was too tiring to swim. I had this discussion with him, talking about how it was when he did gymnastics and the fact that he carried on. And again with this, he accepted, he carried on, and then he got better and better. So then later on, it was the time for roller skate that he wanted to give up. We actually bought him roller skates really when he was really young, but he never really liked them. And sometimes he would do it, sometimes not. He was funny, difficult. And one day when he was, I think, 6 years old, so we went to the park all together. So with my two sons, my youngest on his bike, my eldest on rollerblades, roller skates, and me on my rollerblades as well. And he wanted to use my rollerblades, the inline rollerblades, just because it looked like it was much easier. It's just because I was used to it more, but he thought it was the rollerblades. So he wanted to. And I kept telling him, no, they're too big for you, you can't do that, and you will just injure yourself. But he really, really wanted to, and he told me, but if you don't let me do it, and if you want me to give up, how can I improve? He got me at my own game. So I let him put on my rollerblades that were like adult-sized rollerblades with his small foot inside. And so I just made sure it was really tight so it was okay with his ankles, etc. To be honest, they were really heavy for him, but he still managed to roll a bit. And he was so happy to be able to do that he carried on and carried on and carried on. And after 3 days, he was actually able to skate quite properly. And then we decided to buy him proper sized rollerblades for his age, and then with that he was going much better. Against all odds, because he wanted to do it, he was able to improve rollerblading, roller skating, because he carried on and he had some practice and he didn't give up for 3 days. So now I'm equipped with all these examples that I can throw back at him whenever he wants to give up. So he knows now that, okay, it's difficult, but if I want to improve, I need to carry on. And this happened with reading and writing as well, whether it's in English, French or Korean. At some point, he's demotivated. But he knows now that if he carries on, he gets better. When he started to learn to read in school, in English, he didn't want to, and he was trying to avoid homework where he had to read some books. But later on, he got better and better. And then we started with French and Korean. And a year later, he was a bookworm. He loved reading. So now this example is perfect for my youngest, who is still finding it difficult to read in all his languages. But he can see that with practice, we get better at it. So we have to use every experience our children go through as examples so that they use themselves as proof that they can do it. And they just need to carry on. So basically, we need to show them that before becoming a master, you need to be a beginner. And although most of the book is about how we can develop a growth mindset, Dr. Carol Dweck has written a whole chapter where she explains how we can help our children develop this growth mindset as well. And the main thing I'm going to take away from this chapter is the notion of praise. We often praise our children to say, oh, wow, this is so good, etc. But there are some praise that are helpful, some that are not helpful. In her book, she has described a set of experiments she has conducted with 400 primary school students across the US to determine what kind of praise were good or bad. So every time she started with a quite easy task where she asked the students to complete it. And after that, she praised them. To half of the students, she said, oh, wow, this is so good. You must be so clever. And to the other group, she said, oh, wow, this is so good. You must have put so much effort into it. So the first group was praised for their intelligence and the second group was praised for their effort. And then she asked them to take a second test, either a difficult one or an easy one. And in the group that was praised for the intelligence, only 33% of the students decided to take the difficult one. However, on the one that were praised for their effort, 92% of the students wanted to take it. And she explains that by saying that if we praise a child for being intelligent, they're going to think, okay, they like me because I'm intelligent, so I need to show that I'm intelligent. So if I fail at this test, they think I'm stupid, so why would I show that? I'd better take the easiest one so they keep thinking I'm intelligent. On the other hand, those that were praised for their effort thought, okay, they like when I put effort. So if I take the difficult one, it doesn't matter if I fail, I put more effort into it. And she also recognized that most of the students who were taking, who were praised for the effort enjoyed actually taking the difficult task. However, those who were praised for the intelligence were getting frustrated at not understanding, not getting the difficult problem. So the words we use are so, so, so important with children. The way we praise them need to be for the effort, what we expect them to do, to carry on, to push themselves, and not to fear challenges and to fear failure. And the most interesting part is that she gave every child a third test. The third test was the same as the first one. And really surprisingly, the students who were praised for their intelligence did 20% worse than the first time. However, those praised for the effort did 30% better than the first time. So there is a staggering 50% difference between those who are praised for their intelligence and those who are praised for their effort. This really shows how important it is to praise our children with the right vocabulary. So learning to read and write won't always be easy for our children, or difficult for that matter. We just need to show them that they are going to start somewhere, and with practice, they're going to improve more and more these skills. And as parents, we need to keep in mind that the way we praise our children is going to have a huge impact on how they are behaving, how they're going to take on the next challenge. I hope this video has been helpful. And if you liked it and want to have more tips on teaching your child to read and write in your home languages, make sure to subscribe to your channel and ring the notification button. Bye!